Hello, and thank you for watching my very first blog post to the Women's Song Forum. In this short video, I want to talk about one of my favorite things about one of my favorite song composers. That song composer is Clara Schumann. I'm currently writing a book about the songs of Clara Schumann, and one thing I'm trying to do in the book is pinpoint the hallmarks of her songwriting style, the compositional strategies and techniques that make her songs uniquely her own. In this video, I'll talk about one of those strategies, which I'm calling reading against the grain. Now, by reading against the grain, what I mean is that the flow of the music is at odds with the flow of the poetry. More specifically, Clara Schumann sometimes composes in such a way that the music sections aren't aligned with the poem's stanzas. And she creates this out of alignment, against the grain feeling in a couple different ways. The first way involves fusing together adjacent stanzas by letting the music flow freely across stanza breaks. The second way involves separating individual stanzas in two by, for example, having the vocal melody come to a halt halfway through a stanza and inserting a piano interlude. The easiest way to explain how these two strategies of fusion and separation work is with an abstract example. What you see in front of you are two stanzas from Robert Frost's famous poem, Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. I'm going to read the two stanzas and observe the stanza break. My little horse must think it queer to stop without a farmhouse near between the woods and frozen lake, the darkest evening of the year. He gives his harness bells a shake to ask if there is some mistake. The only other sounds the sweep of easy wind and downy flake. Now what I'm going to do is read them differently. I'm going to fuse the first two lines of the second stanza to the first stanza, and then separate the last two lines of that second stanza from everything that precedes them. This is how the poem would sound with this different pacing. My little horse must think it queer to stop without a farmhouse near between the woods and frozen lake, the darkest evening of the year. He gives his harness bells a shake to ask if there is some mistake. The only other sounds the sweep of easy wind and downy flake. Now I mentioned pacing. Composers of art songs have the ability to control the pacing of a poem, the speed with which we deliver lines. Imagine a composer setting this text and doing something more like what I've done here, creating space between the first six lines and the last two lines. Notice that the first six lines describe the horse, and then the last two lines describe something else, namely the sound of easy wind and downy flake. Now these may seem like fairly straightforward strategies. Keep the music moving forward when the poetry comes to a stop, and put the brakes on in the music when the poetry is moving forward. But in fact, they are quite uncommon in art songs of the 19th century. If you look at art songs from this time period, you'll discover that it's overwhelmingly the norm for musical sections and poetic stanzas to be coordinated. But Clara Schumann often does the opposite. In seven of her songs, she uses fusion or separation or both. Now, you might think to yourself, seven is not a very big number, but we should remember that Clara Schumann wrote only 27 songs, in part because after her husband Robert died in 1856, she basically gave up composition altogether. So 7 out of 27 is actually quite a lot. It's over a quarter of her songs. In the rest of this video, I'll look at one of these seven songs, Lorelei, which uses both fusion and separation and uses them in remarkable and radical ways. Clara Schumann wrote her song Lorelei in 1843, and it's a setting of a poem by the famous German poet Heinrich Heine. He wrote his poem in 1824. Clara Schumann's setting of this poem is one of her most famous songs, and one thing that makes the song so powerful and so visceral is its piano accompaniment. In a lovely analysis of this song by Caitlin Miller, she notes that the piano accompaniment gives voice to the Lorelei. It gives the Lorelei even more agency in Clara Schumann's song than she has in Heinrich Heine's poem. And the way that Clara Schumann does this is by creating a singing melody in the piano, which appears already five measures into the song, and then appears later and we come to recognize that this melody represents the Lorelei's song itself. But the Lorelei's melody does something else, and something no less striking. It severs the poem's stanzas in two. Here is the opening stanza. I'll read it in English translation. This is the narrator speaking and describing the story that we're about to hear. I do not know what it means that I should feel so sad. There's a tale from olden times that I cannot get out of my mind. This is how Clara Schumann might have set this stanza. What I've done here is taken a recording by Barbara Bonney and Vladimir Ashkenazi and done a little audacity magic with it. I've removed the interlude that separates these stanzas. So this is what Clara Schumann might have done, and what you'll hear is a long 8-measure phrase with no break.
Ich weiß nicht, was soll es bedeuten, dass ich so traurig bin. Ein Märchen aus alten Zeiten, das kommt mir nicht aus dem Sinn. Die Luft ist kühl und es dunkel.
But that's not what Clara Schumann actually does. What she does is divide the stanza in half by inserting a 4-measure piano interlude, the Lorelei theme that represents her song. And in this case, that captures the feeling of sadness and agitation that the narrator feels from thinking about this tale from olden times.
Ich weiß nicht, was soll es bedeuten, dass ich so traurig bin.
In a wonderful analysis of this song, Susan Ewens describes this interlude as the instrumental realization of siren song. And what I love about that description is that it captures the power, the force, even the violence of this tune as it separates the stanza. The narrator in Clara Schumann's setting doesn't just stand outside the action and narrate it dispassionately. He's a part of the action. He hears this melody and is drawn forcefully and suddenly into the story. The Lorelei's melody intrudes again later in the piece, and this time its connection with her melody is made even more explicit. This stanza describes her combing her hair. She combs it with a golden comb and sings a song the while. It has an awe-inspiring, powerful melody. Here again is how Clara Schumann might have set these lines without any separation at all. And here is how she actually sets the stanza, with a song that severs the stanza in two. If these are the two moments when Clara Schumann puts on the brakes, they're counterbalanced by moments when she accelerates, when she lets the music flow freely across stanza divisions. There are two such examples in the song, and the first appears directly before the stanza we just looked at. I'll read these two stanzas, and again, notice that in these stanzas, Heine describes the appearance of the Lorelei. The fairest maiden is sitting in wondrous beauty up there. Her golden jewels are sparkling. She combs her golden hair. She combs it with a golden comb and sings a song the while. It has an awe-inspiring, powerful melody. What Clara Schumann does here is fuse together these two stanzas with melodic repetition. If you look at the music at the bottom of the screen, you'll see the vocal melody and the piano's bass line. And notice that in the vocal melody, we hear two different versions of the same motive on either side of this stanza, which links them together somewhat. Furthermore, notice that the piano's bass line features that same motive, but the motive straddles the stanza boundary, fusing them together even more. Here's what this passage sounds like. The melodic similarity, of course, responds to a poetic similarity. We have two musical motives that are repeated across two stanzas, and notice that the last line of that first stanza, "She combs her golden hair," is repeated and varied in the first line of the next stanza, "She combs it with a golden comb." In other words, Clara Schumann seems to be picking up on something in Heine's poem and exaggerating it. Reading against the grain doesn't mean ignoring details of a poem. It sometimes means noticing small details and amplifying them. In this case, the repetition in Heine's poem creates a slight feeling of acceleration. Clara Schumann notices that acceleration and moves ahead even further. She moves even more rapidly across the break between the last two stanzas of the poem, the stanzas that describe the death of the sailor. Here they are in English translation. The "it," the first word of the stanza, by the way, refers to the Lorelei's melody. "It seizes the boatman in his skiff with wildly aching pain. He does not see the rocky reefs. He only looks up to the heights. I think at last the waves swallow the boatman and his boat, and that, with her singing, the Lorelei has done." So how does Clara Schumann fuse together these stanzas? Well, with an even more striking maneuver, she avoids a musical cadence at the end of the first of these stanzas. A musical cadence is the musical equivalent of a punctuation mark. And Clara Schumann does not give us that strong musical punctuation mark. If you look at the music notation, you'll see that the chord in the second measure is what I'm calling a 5-6 chord. It's a D chord in first inversion with an F sharp in the bass. Had it been a D chord in root position with a D in the bass, this would sound like what music theorists call a half cadence. But in this setting, we don't really get a cadence at all. Furthermore, in the melody, we hear a D sounding in the second measure, which repeats across the third and fourth measures. And in the piano's left hand, we likewise hear Ds that sound across this passage. The repeated Ds and the lack of a cadence join together these last two stanzas. Here's how the passage sounds, and I'd ask you to listen not just for the fusion of these last two stanzas, but also for a slight separation after the first two lines, where we hear in the piano a musical evocation of the boatman's pain. So why does Clara Schumann do this? In short, it's because in her setting, the waves, once whipped up, are so powerful that they engulf the final stanza of the poem. Recall that I said in Heine's poem, the narrator seems to stand outside the action, observing it from a distance. In Clara Schumann's setting, he is in the midst of the action. And I would go so far as to say that he is practically engulfed by the waves at the end. I say this in part because of what happens with pronouns in the poem. Notice that the first three lines of this large fused together stanza begin with he, and I. He refers to the boatman and I to the narrator. He does not see the rocky reefs. He only looks up to the heights. I think at last the waves swallow the boatman in his boat. Another composer might underline the difference between pronouns here, creating an even bigger space between these two stanzas. But in Clara Schumann's setting, the narrator and the boatman effectively become one. The Lorelei's powerful melody and the tempest it stirs seem to swallow the last stanza and the narrator with it. Here's the entire song, again in a performance by Barbara Bonney and Vladimir Ashkenazi. As you listen, note where the separations and the fusions appear, and also follow along with the cadences, which I'll show next to the text.
Ich weiß nicht, was soll es bedeuten, dass ich so traurig bin. Ein Märchen aus alten Zeiten, das kommt mir nicht aus dem Sinn. Die Luft ist kühl und es dunkelt und ruhig fließt der Rhein. Der Gipfel des Berges funkelt im Abendsonnenschein.
In 1846, Clara Schumann wrote a diary entry about her piano trio, Opus 17. She wrote this: "There are some pretty passages, but naturally it is still only women's work, which always lacks force and occasionally invention." She routinely expressed doubt about her compositional abilities and also about her reading abilities. She once wrote a letter to her husband, for example, in which she said that she lacked insight into great German poetry, and therefore was not able to compose a great German song. If my video has shown anything, it's that she sold herself short. Lorelei is a great German song. It is full of force and invention, not least because, as I hope to have shown, Clara Schumann carefully controls and sometimes radically disrupts the flow of ideas, images, and emotions. Here, then, is another way that we might understand the expression reading against the grain. Reading against the grain may mean reading against the grain of Clara Schumann's own self-criticism. In short, taking her music even more seriously than the words she wrote about her music. Of course, we need to recognize what those words reveal. They reveal how deeply ingrained were ideas about the insufficiency of women's creativity in this time period. They reveal the many obstacles that she and other women faced and continue to face today as they try to pursue careers as composers. And they reveal how extraordinary, indeed, how heroic it is that she persevered anyway and wrote some of the most lasting and affecting music in the 19th century. But we shouldn't let her words, or the words of others who have sought to minimize her importance as a composer, color our perception of her music. We should assess the nature of her style and the extent of her achievement based on the quality of her work. We should let her music speak for itself.